yeah, I studied DL Nino Southern Oscillation this summer and its implications around the world, and I'm super excited to share with you what I found out. So picture this. You're a farmer in Indonesia. You've had very successful crops this year, and right before you can harvest them, a rapid flood comes in and washes it all away. That's why it's so important to predict these extreme weather events before it's actually on top of you. But how can we predict weather more than a week or so out? Glad you asked. And so, or the El Nino Southern Oscillation refers to two natural phenomena, La Nina and El Nino. And essentially what happens is the sea surface temperature, or SST, it cools for La Nina in the tropical Pacific and it warms for El Nino. And why does this matter? It comes with like a host of climate effects around the world that are super predictable. And like, yeah, super predictable. And it's an important distinction between climate and weather, because weather is kind of what's happening today, tomorrow, and the next week, while climate is what's happening over a longer period, like weeks and months. And this is why we can predict weather much earlier with ENSO. Which leads me to my research question: how does ENSO affect the climate around the world? To solve this question, NOAA gave me many, many decades worth of data, and I chose four variables to look at from 1982 to 2018. They were precipitation, 2 meter temperature, which is just like the temperature of the air you feel, mean sea level pressure, and the sea surface temperature. So I have all this data, and I had to separate it into El Nino data and La Nina data, and then I mapped that data around the world to visualize what ENSO looks like. So I first had to make a time series, and essentially what happens is NOAA, they look at this, they look at this little box right here. It's called the Nino 3.4 index, and it's the region where SST changes the most during an ENSO event. And they kind of take what's called the 3 month running mean, I believe is what it's called. And basically for like 1 day of SST, they go 1.5 months that way, 1.5 months that way, and average it all together, and that's the SST for that day. And they do this so that the SST data is much smoother and easier to look at. Otherwise it would be like very crazy, like even crazier than this. So essentially I get a bunch of dates with their corresponding SST anomalies, and that's what you're seeing here. And all of the dates where the SST anomaly is above one standard deviation, the line moved down a little, okay. But all the dates where the ENSO data is above one standard deviation are ENSO dates, are El Nino dates, and all of the dates where the SST data is below one standard deviation or below the blue line are La Nina dates. Everything in the middle, we just consider normal weather conditions. So now that I had a time series, I can start making some maps. And to start, I had to make climatologies. They're super easy. It's just the average weather around the world. Here you can see for SST, it tends to be warmer around the equator and cooler as you get to the poles. Now with these averages or climatologies for all of my variables, I could start making my anomalies. And basically to make that, I had to take my ENSO data and I subtracted the climatology data or the average data, and I'm given a sort of what's the difference or the anomaly, what's unusual. And you can see here for an SST anomaly map I made that it's cooler right here. That doesn't mean that the water is actually cold, it's just colder than what it normally would be. So now let's look at some cool maps. Naturally for La Nina, it's gonna be cooler in the tropical Pacific, warmer in the El Nino, And this kind of affects the pressure in the water, these changes in temperature. And this leads me to a really big thing, but it's super simple. It's called the jet stream. And the jet stream is basically the flow of air. It's a bunch of high velocity winds going around the world, and it tends to be between high and low pressures. These arrows right here are where I estimated my jet streams to be during my ENSO events. And what's interesting was I found that along these jet streams, there were colder temperatures and more precipitation. So you can see here, there's the jet streams like close to Southern America for El Nino and Northern America in La Nina. And there's colder temperatures sort of around those areas. It's a bit more difficult to see on such a small scale, but on the world scale, the the correlation is much more obvious. And then you can see it pretty clearly here. In Southern America, there's more precipitation for El Nino, where the jet stream is lower. There's more precipitation sort of in like Canada and in that area. La Nina, and it was pretty dry in those southern states. But why does this all matter? So ENSO events can be predicted like a season or so in advance. And if we can predict these ENSO events early enough, we can predict the weather and the climate, and this we can predict like what it will be closer to anyway, weeks to months in advance. It's super helpful. And I also noticed that, changes in SST result in changes in mean sea level pressure, and these changes in mean sea level pressure shift the jet stream, and shifting the jet stream means you're changing where like the colder temperatures and the storminess is going to be, and it just that's what I thought. Special thanks to my mentors, real quick, John, Melissa, and Brandon. I'm not sure any of them are here.
I'm so sorry,
you stuck it. And of course, the Rex program. Thank you so much. I'm super excited to have you answer any questions.